going on.
Wait.
Both of these teams are as well, Jim. They both played excellent basketball to get to this point. One of the things to look for early is how does Kentucky deal with the frontline trio of Henson, Barnes, and Zell?
Both teams, as you would expect when you play early December, of course, are going to be greatly improved as the season marches on, but they have a lot different look, too.
Exactly.
Like Marshall only played 10 minutes in that first game. Spin move, Barnes off the glass for two.
He is so tough and playing with so much confidence. 22 points a game over his last nine, and he's been at 22 a game here in the tournament as well.
Harrelson coming off a double-double, but he commits a turnover here. First time he touches it tonight. Strickland coming in and trying to swing it around to Henson. Somehow it got to him. This is the short one. And it's out of bounds off Carolina.
Early on, Josh Harrelson playing man-to-man against Zeller. Going to try to keep him from that left shoulder jump hook. Use that big, strong body of his, and then just try to play as tall as he can to make him shoot over the top. And I thought Friday night, DeAndre Liggins was the key to the game, as Barnes going to be called for the foul there on the nice pass from Knight to Harrelson.
Well, Liggins came off the bench in that one and gave them some huge minutes.
He did.
And here you look at the combined seeds in a Final Four game. We're going to have a record there with VCU and Butler. Combined 19 is what it adds up to. And it tops that George Mason, Florida. If you will, combine those two from a few years back.
Yeah, Liggins had 11 of his 15 points, Jim, in that second half. But I thought he was terrific defensively. And he also did a nice job of making decisions off the dribble. He went for his own a couple of times, but he also had three assists in that game as well. Six rebounds, three block shots. That is what we call a stat sheet stuffer supreme, especially with what was at stake in that game.
And that's Knight stepping in. Saw the pass coming. Knight. Knows Miller is trailing, and he misses on the three. Zeller with the box out. Zeller had his career high in that first game, 27, which held up until the Long Island game to open this year's tournament. Barnes short, but picks it up off one hop.
Long rebounds, long misses lead to long rebounds, and guards have to get back in there and pick them up off the floor for Kentucky.
And Marshall, front of the rim, off the glass and in.
Both of these teams don't mind getting up and down. I know the Wildcats have only averaged 64 points a game in the tournament, Jim, but on the season, they score 76 a game, so they don't mind getting up and down a little bit. If it's not there, they'll pull it out and try to spread you out and run the half-court offense.
Liggins over Marshall. And Henson, the only one underneath. He is a rebounding machine, double-figure rebounds, 15 consecutive games. Now looking for the lob to him, and no foul. Defended by Harrelson. Knight taken off for Kentucky. Goes inside Liggins for two.
Nicely done. And just as I said, Kentucky will look to push the ball ahead when the opportunity is there, and that was well executed by the Wildcats.
Teron Lamb comes in, freshman from Queens, New York. He's got a local contingent here, as you might expect.
Mm-hmm.
Excited about coming back in his home area. He's a freshman who can fill it up too. He had a 32-point game this season.
He has not been on top of his game since he sprained his ankle in the SEC championship game. It seems to be close to 100%, and he's capable of erupting offensively.
It was off Liggins. Stays with Carolina.
Last time Tyler Zeller caught it in the post, the Wildcats sent a double team from Terrence Jones at him. So let's keep an eye on that. If in fact he gets it inside, will they continue to double team, or was that just a one-time situation? Well, that's what they did against Jared Sullinger. The first time he caught it, they doubled him, and then they played him straight up the rest of the way.
And this is going to prevent again. You've talked about it many times.
We got to change it.
Kentucky break off the shot clock violation.
Yeah, I would like to see the rules committee really look at that. If that ball is reeled in by the defensive team and they've got clear possession of it, let them push it ahead. They played good defense for the 35 seconds. Don't penalize them by giving the opponent an opportunity to get its defense set.
And Knight puts up a three. Brandon Knight. Knight with two game winners, Princeton and Ohio State.
And in between those game winners, he had a 30-point eruption against West Virginia.
Kentucky with another block. Knight with a pull-up three. And not two in a row this time. But tapped in. Tapped in by Harrelson.
That's what happens, Jim, when you push that ball ahead quickly and get a quality shot. Defenders are scrambling. That lane to the offensive glass is available.
Zeller can't leave him open. He's got an outside game.
Big fella. He can run the floor. He's got the jump hook. And if you don't get up in his shirt, he can hurt you from 17 or 18 feet as well.
Maybe has had the best set of three games going into the Elite Eight than anyone in the tournament. And that's a nice soft roll. As Lamb gets the two. Marshall, short.
We've got to get back and get matched up because Knight is coming at him quick.
Lamb driving in, Zeller. And they call it on Kentucky, the charge on Lamb.
Here we'd like to show you the effect of a good double team. Ball here, defender here, and then Terrence Jones is going to come down here and body up, wall up on Tyler Zeller, and as a result, they're going to be able to get a deflection. You see that Harrelson takes away the jump hook and then the good extended hands by Jones. Zeller was off balance, and as a result, Kentucky got a turnover. Now, I'm not sure if John Calipari will employ that every time he catches it there, but that first time, surprisingly, they jumped on Zeller and forced the turnover.
Carolina brings in Justin Watts, number 24. As Barnes takes it from the outside, and good box out by Terrence Jones.
That's a little quick and challenged. You want to move the ball a little more than that, Jim, if you're Carolina.
That's Dexter Strickland with the steal, taking it inside. Oh, man, what a collision.
Goodness.
And some elevation.
I'm telling you, both of those guys went airborne.
That was Knight converging, called for the foul.
Big time play above the rim, and these guys aren't that big. Boy, that was well challenged by Knight, and another close-up look. Boy, a lot of ball, but he got some arm and body as well. Excellent play both ways, an aggressive take by Strickland. And not giving up on it was Knight.
Strickland gets the first one, high off the back of the rim.
Well, he's been so solid, Jim. His speed is really a weapon when he gets a ball in the open court, as he did there off the steal, but also when he can push it ahead, and his defense has been splendid.
Talked about Lamb from Kentucky, a local kid. Strickland from Rahway, New Jersey. Played at St. Patrick High School in nearby Elizabeth for Coach Kevin Ball. Strickland trying to defend again. Harrelson left wide open and hits the open J.
That's an unknown aspect of his game, Jim. Josh Harrelson can make the face-up jumper out to the three-point line.
Barnes and one. And it's on Miller.
Brandon Knight rotating defensively, and he is so good at pushing the ball ahead for his own shot or finding a teammate. And what I like about him, Jim, as a point guard, you can run screen action for him without the ball, and he does an excellent job coming off screens and getting into a shot.
Now, Brandon Knight was considered by some the National Player of the Year both his junior and senior year, but USA Today had Harrison Barnes last year as its National Player of the Year.
You wouldn't go wrong taking either one of them.
We've got them both on the floor today as the Knight. And that goes to Barnes off the floor. Henson, show his little baby hook, little jump hook, left hand Henson.
The rubber band man. You can extend.
That's a good one. That is a really good one.
You can stretch out and cover a lot of ground.
Miller with a three. Got it. Darius Miller. He was the MVP of the SEC tournament. And Kentucky really began to rev it up. Ran through the tournament. Some thought they merited better than a four seed.
Well, we've seen that the seed number is nice on Selection Sunday. But after that, it's out the window.
Yeah, it's not mattering too much this year. Oh, McDonald thought someone was there. Tried to save it. And Kentucky, McDonald's going to, in turn, foul Brandon Knight.
Yeah, that was disastrous from the start, wow. Wasn't it, partner? Unfortunate for Leslie McDonald.
Looked like Georgetown, North Carolina for a minute there, 1982.
Yeah, that's
turnaround,
right.
No one's there.
But a good brisk pace both ways. I really think Leslie McDonald, who has struggled with his shot, Jim, for a while now. I mean, in his last six games, he's only made 7 of 22 threes. I think he's got to be able to knock down a couple of threes here today when the opportunity presents itself.
Look how high Henson goes to pull that one down.
He's a designated perimeter shooter for this Carolina team.
He's Knox. Came in from Alabama, attending graduate school. That's the fourth turnover for the Tar Heels.
Only averaged 10 a game in the tournament.
Harrison blocked, but no, there was a piece of the arm. Foul's called on Henson. Get coverage of the Division I women's basketball tournament at NCAA.com/Final Four. First on Henson, and Harrelson to the line to shoot a couple. He said this was a little known part of his game when he hit that jumper. Well, there's a lot about his game we didn't know because he barely played last
year.
That's
right. 88 minutes, Jim. 28 points is all he had. Is the Dex Factor, they call him, Dexter Strickland, because he is such an X Factor defensively. They call him Dex Factor back in. Lamb is back as well. But you're right, Harrelson didn't play much at all last year. But his confidence has just grown as a result of the work he put in terms of conditioning and the confidence that's been shown in him by his teammates and his coaching staff. And his greatest attribute before becoming a real force inside was the fact that he could shoot the basketball.
Vargas comes in for Kentucky. Harrelson, it's a break here at 12:29.
And Jim, one of the last things that ever leaves from you as a basketball player is your ability to shoot. I can vouch for that. I can't move very well, but I can still shoot it a little bit.
Harrelson yesterday over here was talking about how when he first started playing in high school, he couldn't even make it with a layup. Struggled. Tried left-hand layup. Anything. Couldn't make it. Here's McDonald from a three. Actually grazed the top of the glass and still almost went in. Moving it ahead quickly. Knight pull up short. And Henson again snares it for the Tar Heels.
Well, good job by Knight to control Strickland, because he really puts pressure on you when he's coming at you full speed with the basketball.
This is Knox. A lot of experience going against Kentucky from his days at Alabama.
Good job by Vargas, though, not to let him turn into the middle.
Here's Knox again over Vargas. Short. Henson. Got three Wildcats around him. Dump nice. It back in. Knox this time. Oh, that was clean. Well, it's going to be a foul instead on Miller. And that'll be his second. Well, Josh Harrelson has 8. Brandon Knight leading the charges again. Win VCU with the shocker. The game we had here Friday night with Ohio State, the overall number one seed of the tournament.
Well, Jim, we talked about it all year long. No clear-cut dominant team this season in college basketball. I think anybody you talk to would agree with that, and it's played itself out here in the tournament.
Knox at the line for two off of Miller's second foul.
And I've always said the three-point shot is a tremendous equalizer. I mean, that VCU team is outstanding. Jamie Skene could have played anywhere, was at Wake Forest for a couple of years. But when you can make the three and you've got good guard play, that's a tremendous equalizer.
Here's what I like about the VCU run. I know you're not a big conference affiliation guy when you get to the tournament, but it says something about the little guy here in the tournament. Not just saying specifically the Rams. They beat the Pac-10's USC, Big East Georgetown, Big Ten Purdue. Then they beat the ACC's Florida State, and then Kansas out of the Big 12 today. So they played 5 power conference teams, if you will, and they beat the Giants in every case.
And they are really good. It always helps as Terrence Jones tries to get inside against that big front line. Had a pretty clean look at it, Jim, and just didn't finish. Sometimes it's not about blocking the shot. It's about bothering it, and that's what Henson did there.
Henson is off his knee.
Another turnover for North Carolina. The difference so far, Jim, is three-point shooting for Kentucky, 2 of 5, as Zeller comes in, and then turnovers for North Carolina. They have averaged only 11 turnovers a game in the tournament, 34 turnovers in the three tournament games to this point. And they've already had 5 turnovers.
Well, they had only 7 for the game against Mark Peck.
That's right.
They shellacked the Golden Eagles on Friday night, had a 40-15 halftime lead.
The defense was saran wrapped tight. Kentucky's been excellent taking care of the ball, too. They've squeezed the orange to the tune of only averaging 10 turnovers a game in the tournament.
They haven't had a basket on either side for over 3 minutes. Reached the midway point of this first half, and that's going to be a push-off on McDonald. And that will be his second. See stories of student-athletes and their achievements on the Buick Human Highlight Reel at NCAA.com/Buick. That was the 4th team foul. And again, McDonald second. North Carolina goes back to his first 5. Meanwhile, this is on Henson, and this will get your attention because that's his 2nd. Team foul 5. The 10:07. We'll leave Henson on the floor with 2 fouls. Yeah, no movement.
Bit of a risk, but I'm not sure if Roy feels like he has an option right now, Jim. I mean, you would go to Justin Knox. He's expecting Henson to be able to play without picking up this 3rd, at least until maybe the next time out.
Off the fingertips of Harrelson. And Jones almost making things a little crazy down there for Carolina, trying to get a clean handle on it. Now Zeller.
No double, no double, just a dig, and then the double comes late. The shot bothered and way off. Good defense by Kentucky there.
Liggins goes cross court. From the corner, that's Lamb. Lamb. He was the top 3-point shooter in the SEC by percentage.
47 it is, Jim. And when he's open, he cashes the bet.
An 8-0 run by Kentucky. Zeller kicks it back out. Marshall has to take it wide open. He's hit a couple from the outside, although that's the first 3. For North Carolina.
And based on how Kentucky is going to mix up double teaming the low post, Carolina is going to need to be able to make a few 3s, Jim. You've got to have that in your arsenal in the college game today. You've got to be able to knock down timely 3s to beat high quality opponents.
Harrelson, hook shot in the lane. Flying through, it's Henson with another rebound. His 5th. Driving all night. Zeller, put back. 5 quick ones for Carolina.
Well, both of these teams have spurt ability, Jim. They can put together scoring runs because they can shoot the 3, but they also can attack quickly, running the floor and scoring in transition. So you think that Kentucky might try to go at Henson with Terrence Jones, being that Henson has the 2 fouls, maybe create some type of isolation for him. Got him in the pick and roll now. Switched it.
That's Knight stepping up, hits the jumper.
Well, he's textbook perfect on that jumper. He's straight up and straight down, shoulder square, and a perfect release.
5 for Knight. Henson, Jones behind him. Too strong, and all Kentucky underneath. Takes it. He moves up that floor and
overshot it.
Way too strong.
Sometimes when you're going that fast, it's hard to soften up the shot.
Liggins bypasses another 3 attempt. That's too strong. Harrelson working hard on the inside.
Nice job by Kentucky to get back on the early push ahead by Marshall.
10 for Harrelson. Inside 7 minutes, Kentucky by 7. 25-18 Wildcats. Zeller on the floor, and it comes out to Wiggins.
They're not letting him turn to that left shoulder.
Gives it up to Knight.
I think they're going to call that on perhaps Harrelson. Coming over the top, or did they get one of the Carolina players? I'm not sure where the foul was called.
Might have been on Henson. It is. It's his third. That's a big one. Jim Nance, Clark Kellogg, Tracy Wolfson in Newark, New Jersey. You see Henson, 7 rebounds and 3 fouls. And Carolina contingent here wanted a traveling call, but it wasn't, in fact, made at all here. And it led to that pivotal third foul. Here it is.
Well, you see Strickland gets his hands on the ball a little bit there. And it looked to me like Knight may have gotten it on the rim before his foot hit the ground. And then you see Henson coming into Josh Harrelson, and that was his third foul. And Jim, you asked me when Henson picked up his second, is this a risk? And it is, but I'm not one that automatically thinks you have to take a guy out right away when he picks up his second foul in the first half. That's always in my mind a judgment call based on the coach, circumstance in the game, and how confident he is in his player to be able to play with two fouls.
6:39. I don't expect to see him the rest of this half as Harrelson will shoot one more. And that's Watts on the floor, taking John Henson's minutes. With the two.
Zeller has been bottled up by the good aggressive defense, the body of Josh Harrelson, and then the stunning digging in there when the ball goes in there, and also a double team or two has shown up to be effective for Kentucky and dealing with Zeller. That being the case, maybe he needs to step outside and try to utilize that nice face-up jumper of his.
Barnes lost it, but right back to Marshall. And they've got numbers here, 4-on-3. Bouncing it inside, Zeller. His third basket of the game, he's got 6. Talking about 82 points the first 3 games by Zeller, including career high 32. It eclipsed the 27, which previous high established against Kentucky back on December the 4th, 32 against LIU.
And 30 of those points, Jim, have come at the foul line. He's 30 of 36 from the free throw line.
Jones.
I like that. He's got a huge advantage on Justin Ross. And I wouldn't be surprised to see Kentucky go to that every time in the half court.
And Marshall decides to penetrate and draw the foul. So on Wiggins tonight on 60 Minutes. This is some story. I've seen it. Legendary coach Bob Hurley over at St. Anthony's. Hall of Famer. He had 5 kids, in fact, who were in the NCAA tournament this year.
Yeah.
He's developed some kind of program, but it's more than just winning basketball games, which he's done so many times. It's developing character.
That's right.
Developing people. And that story with Steve Croft tonight.
Yeah, helping those guys be winners in life, not just between the lines. And that obviously will last longer than any type of basketball you're going to play, even if you do go on to college and perhaps the next level.
Need to see the man tonight on 60 Minutes. It's 5 team fouls on Kentucky.
They're going to try to put it in Terrence Jones' hands and maybe get him down on the block again.
Jones. Doubled up here. Knows there's an open man. Lamb, he's got 2 threes now. His father was the scorer. His father, Calvin, big-time scorer over at Long Island University in his day. He's here watching his son today. Ties the biggest lead of the game at 8. Barnes brings it right back to 5.
That's not an easy shot, Jim. He's fading away, going to his left. And I mean, just great. Jones kept that alive, Jim. Seems like Kentucky getting most of the loose balls and also forcing more turnovers and making more threes. That's why they're on the lead.
Now Wiggins. Open man corner. It's Jones. And since Henson went out, he's made a two and a three. Up ahead. Seven. Beats him down to the floor. Waits. And one.
Boy, that is fantastic basketball. Both ways.
Timeout. Zeller will be at the line. Going to have a number one seed down in Houston. VCU and Butler will square off in one national semifinal. How about the Bulldogs? How about Coach Stevens doing it again? They lose Gordon Hayward and they come back this year. People were talking up Old Dominion, their first round opponent, not Butler, right from the get-go.
Yeah.
And others were saying about VCU, one of the last teams in. It was a joke, some even went so far to say. And they, of course, they had to play that extra game in the first four.
And they played five. They've played five to this point already, Jim, to get to the final four. But they never looked at it as an excuse. All they talked about was the opportunity to get it done between the lines. And they've certainly done that. Hats off to them. I look forward to seeing them in Houston.
I do, too. That's three-point play for Zeller off the Liggins foul and the second on Liggins. 16th out on Kentucky as we went to the break.
My line about that is have game, it will travel. If you've got game, it'll take you places, and they've got plenty of game.
They've gone from Dayton to Chicago to San Antonio, next stop, Houston.
Yep.
Spin move, Miller. And that goes to Carolina off Harrelson.
Well, Miller got in there nicely, just rushed the shot again. Matchup advantages with Henson on the bench with three fouls now. Terrence Jones is being defended by a smaller guy, as is Darius Miller. He was being defended by McDonald and had a good look at a five-footer that he just misfired on. That's what Kentucky will do to you, Jim. They'll spread you out and then find out where is the matchup advantage and then let that player go to work individually.
Oh. Just bounced it off the glass.
He tried to pass it himself. He tried to. That's what he was trying to do.
He was stuck.
Yeah.
He knew that was his only option.
Yeah, it was. Pretty smart play, but Kentucky got a hand on it.
Well, that looked like that was off Jones. They say that Barnes touched it last.
Well, you see, right, he was hemmed up here. May have gotten away with the walk there, Jim. May have picked that pivot foot up before he got the ball on the glass. The effort was thwarted. And there you see the shooting. Kentucky has been so efficient. That win against Ohio State, they shot 46% by allowing Ohio State to shoot only 34.
Just up ahead. Traveling. Now eight turnovers for North Carolina. Coming up AT&T at the half. Greg, Kenny, and Charles recap VCU's win to get to the Final Four. You'll hear from them, the winners, and see the net cutting. And we'll also speak live with Kimball Walker and Jeremy Lamb of Final Four bound UConn, plus a Naismith watch presented by AT&T coming up AT&T at the half.
It's a full package at halftime.
A lot of ground to cover. A lot of stories to tell.
Yeah.
Just down in the corner, and Marshall is there. We approach 2 minutes to play in the half. Kentucky's had a steady lead. High is eight. Barnes. Jones.
Numbers 5-on-4. Zeller's on the floor on the baseline.
Lamb. And that's going back the other way.
Stepped out of bounds. Lost his footing there. So a little ragtag both ways the last couple of minutes here, Jim. And that bodes well for Carolina because they've been out of sync more than Kentucky has been in this first half. As you look at John Henson with three personal fouls, obviously disappointed and in a bit of a quandary. I mean, you have three at halftime, Jim. You come out in that second half, you're in a real precarious position as a guy who's a shot blocker and rebounder.
He's been out for almost 5 minutes. North Carolina plus four now in that time with the deck by Zeller. Zeller has 11.
And for all the good work Kentucky has done on him defensively, Jim, I mean, I'm surprised you said that. He's got 11 points. He just stays with it, though. You know, he missed 33 games his first 2 years due to injury. And he's played 30-plus this year already, so.
Nice. kind of quietly operates for so long. You give him just the slightest little opening.
Well, he's going with his routine here in the tournament. He had 2 points in the first game, 30 the second game, struggled in game three with only 9, and now he's on his way to perhaps a big double-digit effort.
Charge on Barnes. Barnes is going to sit the final 59-9 with 2 fouls. Sitting along Henson, who has the 3, and Harrison. Here's his mother, Shirley. She doesn't miss the games. She's a secretary at Iowa State University in the Department of Music. Had a chance to visit with her son each of the last 2 weeks. He is, you can talk about his talent on the court. Wide range of interest. Great young man.
Very impressive trap here at half court, but that leaves Brandon Knight is wide left there. Boy, but that was a good look. But you can't usually get him.
McDonald in the paint. Swatted out of there to Lamb. Knight. Traylor Jones and one. Wow, did they run the break.
And he really puts it ahead. Brandon Knight is excellent at really thrusting that ball forward.
It's 2-on-2, and Jones was hustling. Look at it come breaking down.
Yep, the trailer, he beat both Watts and McDonald that time. Beat them both and got between them and protected the ball nicely.
The call was on Marshall, by the way, his first call.
Yeah, solid effort here for Terrence Jones in the first half.
North Carolina.
Need to make sure you get the last shot here, Jim.
That lead back up. Matching the largest of the game, 38-30. Kentucky brings in John Hood, number 4.
We gave him a nice minute or two the other night as well, Jim. Didn't do a lot in the score sheet, but handled the ball and gave one of his teammates a rest.
It's a kick by Jones, 5.5, North Carolina at inbound. Carolina's going to sub in Barnes. They're going to bring him back out.
Well, you would expect they try to get it into his hands, and he's got to be smart enough not to go in there trying to make a play and put himself in jeopardy of committing a third foul.
Good move by Roy Williams. Give him another shooter here.
Yep.
In the final seconds.
And Roy upset because they've delayed giving Barnes the ball. He thought he could catch Kentucky off stride here.
Zeller finds him. Barnes puts it up. Short. Henry reach halftime. Indianapolis and Storrs, Connecticut and Richmond, Virginia. And it will be in about an hour's time in Lexington or Chapel Hill as we solve this final piece to the puzzle. Roy all over those 9 turnovers.
Yeah, well, you can't afford to have that many and a half. If you only averaged 11 a game in the tournament, Jim, the 3-point shooting a big difference as well. Kentucky made 6, North Carolina only made 2, and the guys in the studio were all over it, talking about fast break points in favor of Kentucky. The 3-point shooting has been a bit of a problem all season long for Carolina. So they've got to dominate the points in the paint game and get some threes to go like this.
That's Marshall.
When they get looks like that, they've got to knock down a decent percentage of them.
Up ahead, Liggins dumps it over, picked up by Henson. Henson was set to final 6:39. They were down 7 when he went out. Down 8 at halftime. Strickland cuts it to 6 with the lead. 38-32 Wildcats. And a timeout. John Calipari says, hold on a minute, guys. Don't like the way we came out this first minute. Let's talk things over in 11 days' time. Masters Live, by the way, will be streaming exclusive video of Amen Corner, 15 and 16, and featured group. For more, go to cbssports.com/masters and masters.com.
Well, a quick timeout by John Calipari because of what you just said, Jim. 2 turnovers and then a runout for North Carolina. That's not exactly what they diagrammed in the game plan, which they executed quite well in the first half. They wanted to get their attention and get them back on task, and the aggressiveness of North Carolina. Tracy Wolfson told us that was one of the things Roy Williams talked about. Let's become the aggressors and attack them. And that goes both ways, Jim. You attack offensively by getting the ball inside, pushing it ahead, and you attack defensively by getting up into people.
3 Kentucky touches, 3 turnovers. And that dogged defensive effort by Dexter Strickland, which maybe goes too unnoticed too often at the time. The motor's going all the time. Inside, and Zeller. And Carolina cuts it to 4. Great pass in there. The bounce pass from Marshall.
Pretty good catch too when you've got a 7-footer going down and getting a low one like that.
Lamb driving in. Sellers says no way. And Henson lost control of it. He tried to go long, then tried to stop it, and it slipped out of his hand.
Well, that's what happens if you don't have two hands on the gym. Can't pass for one-handed pass.
Reaching in from behind. Knightley had gotten away with a foul. Tarns with a three. Slides off the rim. Miller. Well, that would have cut it to one. Harrison running down the floor, and he is knocked down.
I think it was Harrison Barnes, Jim, on the trip.
He has a few words for Harrison Barnes.
Well, here you take a look, and that's exactly what it was. Inadvertent, nothing intentional. Legs just got caught up, I think. I mean, I can't see anything other than that. A pair of legs got caught up, and Harrison got the worst of it.
Well, that's Barnes' third.
Yeah, yeah. Harrison got the worst of it, clearly, but long-term, that third personal foul on Barnes could very well be the bigger story, but Roy Williams making no move to bring Barnes out.
And Strickland reached in trying to tap the ball over to Henson. That's his first. So Barnes with three, Henson with three.
Well, I think Roy is going to try to get to this first media timeout, Jim, and maybe consider. I think he feels his team has some good rhythm here and good aggressiveness, and Barnes could be effective offensively for him. Just going to trust the freshman to be able to be smart about it and not commit the fourth.
No one's better at defending the inbounds pass. This would be tough from the corner for Lamb. Really tough. Really tough. Got it in just in time to Miller. Henson deflects so many of those.
Yeah, we've seen him do it a couple of times during the tournament, too.
Liggins. That's a big three to get Kentucky on the board. Bounce pass up ahead, and it's Harrison who saw it coming.
Only a few times Marshall has kind of telegraphed his pass. He gave the defenders a chance to react to that one. And that was a huge three. You're right, Jim. That was a big three. I think Harrison may be bleeding
on the knee. So the officials stop play. Tonight on CBS, a CEO takes on the dirtiest job ever. And a new undercover boss tonight only on CBS America's number one network. So, with the blood on the knee, he sits. That's another three. Oh, and it's Knight. And Kentucky got off to a sloppy start here in the second half, but next thing you know, thanks to Liggins and thanks to Knight, they now have their biggest lead of the game, up to 10.
Jim, shot making can cover over a multitude of sins. When you can knock down shots, you can overcome some of your mistakes, especially if they're triples.
First on Jones. See what Carolina can do to take advantage of the fact Harrelson's out.
Really a tough matchup at the other end because all five of the guys on the floor. There you go. Good look inside.
That's what they did.
And that's exactly the point you were making in terms of being able to attack inside. But at this end of the floor, Jim, now you've got five guys out there in dark blue that can dribble drive you and shoot the three-point shot.
Another three. Rims out, but Miller jumps up to the spot. And look out number four on Henson.
That's all because of the spacing created with 5 3-point shooters out there. You miss a long shot, the offensive rebounding lanes are available. And then excellent patience here by Darius Miller to be under control, to draw the foul. And that's the case where Henson has to concede the two.
You were saying, can they get it to the under 16 timeout without Barnes or Henson picking up another one? 16:03, he goes out with four. And now Miller completes the three-point play.
Well, a big answer because the deficit was only four just a little bit ago, Jim, before Kentucky got back-to-back threes and then an old-fashioned three-point play there. get to work with Zeller. But you got to be able to pass out of double teams and make an outside shot if you're Carolina.
Knox. He got pushed by Vargas. We got a timeout. Kentucky hitting from the outside with the legs of Liggins. Henson with four. Played 12 minutes in that first half. He's going to be sitting for a while.
And he only played what, maybe three in the second half.
He got it down to near the under 16 timeout.
Oh,
there's
okay.
Zeller.
So he may be credited with four then.
Seven out of nine from the field. And Knox, who took Henson's place, will shoot a couple. He graduated, did Knox, from Alabama last year, and he still had a year of eligibility. Mm-hmm. And because they had his graduate program at Chapel Hill, he was able to come here to play 1 year of basketball. Never played in postseason tournament for the Crimson Tide. They never qualified NIT or NCAA. But he saw plenty of Kentucky. In fact, talking to him yesterday, he said, you know, I had a game last year against DeMarcus Cousins where he had 11 rebounds against Kentucky and Cousins, and Cousins did not score the first 25 minutes.
Well, they're going to need his experience and his body here in the second half for sure, Jim. Dustin Watts on the floor now. Gives him a little better opportunity to match up on the perimeter with Kentucky, and another turnover forced by Carolina. Defensively, I think Carolina is going to be okay. Obviously, you missed the shot blocking presence of John Henson, but offensively is where they've got to be able to play inside out. And to get all the way back, I think it's going to take making a couple of threes at some point.
Watts is back on the floor for Carolina. That's off the foot of the Wildcats, off Liggins.
Now, if you don't knock down threes, then if you're Carolina, you want to get inside and maybe draw fouls and then win the free throw game, which is what they did in the meeting back in December. Dominated the free throw game, and Barnes off balance there.
Carolina 2 out of 10 from three.
They only make 5 a game on 15 attempts, Jim, and it's been well documented that is not a strength of this team, shooting the perimeter shot.
Wild shot put up by Liggins. Up ahead, Strickland. Takes it in. Got it to go. Plus one. Strickland. We had Watts coming in from that right side. Decided to keep it and draws the foul on Lamb.
Yeah, I agree with you. I thought he had a pass to make, but that's the decision of the player with the ball. He had inside position. And I tell you what, he gets up on you in a heartbeat. I mean, two dribbles, no more than that, and he's at the rim. I mean, that is mercurial speed there.
Lamb goes to the bench with two. Jones back on the floor for Kentucky. And Strickland, 6 points, 3 rebounds. Brings the Tar Heels back within 6. Knox was just out briefly. He'll come in for Watts. Justin for Justin. That was Lamb sitting down on the Kentucky bench. Had 4 turnovers this half, including the first 3 possessions. Then they caught fire again with a couple of shots from the outside. Liggins and then Knight. Big 3-point play on the inside by Miller. Knight.
Dangerous when you try to go underneath Knight. He can shoot the 3 on you.
Oh, that shot goes somehow. Power move by Harrelson, and Zeller charged with that one, his first.
Jim, this is just an excellent play by Harrelson. A tough shot, but when you get your body on the defender, it gives you a chance to get off a controlled shot, and that's just what he did. He basically overpowered. Pretty good defense that time from Zeller.
Rebound to the corner to Miller.
That's twice now he's come up with a big offensive rebound. Once off a missed 3-point field goal that he turned into a 3-point play. Now let's see if Kentucky gets another basket off of Miller. Offensive rebound.
Double team, Harrelson outside, doesn't want it. Knight thought about it.
And two-man basketball here.
Yep, finally Knight takes the shot.
Jim, the two biggest plays of the game, Darius Miller made it to this point. Offensive rebound off a missed three. Offensive rebound off a missed free throw leads to 5 points for Kentucky.
Knox on the follow-up.
Justin Knox.
Yeah, those two plays by Miller.
Huge right now because they stem the momentum that North Carolina had started to build. Still plenty of time, a long way to go, but.
Another one slipped out of the hands of Knight. Strickland takes it in and lays it up and in. The Carolina keeps threatening to catch up, then Kentucky spaces it out some more. Strickland with 9, 7 coming in this half. Leslie McDonald defending the ball here.
Strickland defending Knight, who has been careless with the ball at times during his outstanding freshman season.
Miller from the wing. Yes! Miller keeps adding to the big moments. That one, the favorite shot on the floor for Zeller, doesn't go. Ball on Knox of North Carolina, his first. And Tuesday, don't miss an all-new episode of TV's number one drama, NCIS. Chris O'Donnell, only CBS. So Knox, again, his first, team foul number 5.
3-point shooting, but you're right, Darius Miller putting together his own little highlight package as far as game-changing type plays here for Kentucky.
Stolen, Strickland saves it to McDonald, smartly.
Yeah, we won't add that one to Darius Miller's list. It was his pass that got pilfered.
Zeller. Right over Harrelson, and he's got 17.
Got to that left shoulder.
Carolina, these last few trips without Barnes on the floor. And he's ready to check in, but there will be a timeout off the next whistle. Knight chasing it down corner, and he tries to ricochet it off Strickland. Harrelson's there to pick it up.
Good ball handling by the big fella there.
You know, you said it in the first half. Seems like most of the loose balls are going to the Wildcats.
They're scratching and clawing. That's how they've gotten to this point, Jim. They're a resilient, tough-minded group, and you couldn't say that when you saw them back in December or January, but they've grown into that. From caterpillar to butterfly. I think you can say that about both teams.
Liggins backs it home. Kentucky team that comes in here at 28-8, but got blown out only once this year, and that was by UConn, the opponent of the winner of this game. UConn beat them 17, but they had 6 road losses, Kentucky, by a total of 11. Driving in Marshall. Knox with the putback, and he has produced some big moments stepping in for Henson.
Well, he's a mature guy, experienced. We talked about his SEC experience, so he's not in awe, and he's called upon now, needed, and providing a nice contribution.
He's had 6 points since Henson went out. Henson's been on the bench for 5.5.
We want Terrence to go one-on-one here due to the Kentucky bench.
And that's going the other way. Second time now, Zeller draws the charge, and a break in the action here in Newark. As Barnes comes back in, still things to be settled at this beautiful new building here in Newark, New Jersey. Jeff Vanderbeek, the president and chairman of this great edifice, and man who leads the Devils and brought this here and part of the program to really rejuvenate things here in Newark. I know that Mayor Booker's so excited to host this regional here in Newark. It's been quite a set of games we've had so far, going back to Ohio State, Kentucky.
And you're right, a beautiful building, and the action on the floor has been outstanding. And the Dex Factor getting right to the rim.
The Dex Factor coming up big. He's got 11-9 in this half. Down to 5.
It seems like every time that North Carolina seems to have some momentum this half, Kentucky answers with a 3.
Just like that. Just like that again. Knight.
That's been the story, Jim. When you're coming from behind, you get momentum. the team that's on the lead has to be able to answer. Good look for McDonald, and that's big.
That
because he's
two.
A capable three-point shooter. Although that wasn't a three. But you figure you've got so many runs in you when you're trying to come from behind. Kentucky, on the other hand, is trying to thwart them and hold them off as long as they can. And that's the battle we've got going on now, that tug of war.
How much longer do you sit out Henson? 9 minutes to play.
I think it's a manageable game, Jim, and you have to continue to trust that the guys that are out there are going to get it done for you. Knox has been very solid in his role replacing Henson.
Big grab by Bulls, who goes with first. He sailed past two Kentucky players. His first field goal since 5 minutes remained in the first half. Kentucky's trailed this game for only a minute and 27 seconds, led by as many as 11. And Henson is checking in off the next whistle, and that's a block by Zeller. His second block of the game.
Harrison is feeling it. If he gets a good look at it, he's going to strike it.
You can see in his eyes, he wants it. He wanted it right there. But Liggins got in position to shut him off. Meanwhile, Strickland. No foul call as he comes up short.
An excellent drive, though. Terrific attack by Dexter Strickland. Now Kentucky content to set things up, space the floor. Look at how wide open the lane is, Jim. Everybody lifted. That creates driving lanes and kicks when you penetrate.
He's hit one from this spot. Not this time. Tapped out. And last touched by Carolina. So it'll go to Kentucky coming out of the timeout. Kentucky 10 out of 18 from three. Barnes though with a beautiful move. Carolina trying to chip away. All right, Greg, again, no number one makes it. And if Kentucky wins this one, no number two makes it.
That's right. We're going to take a look at what's happened here in the second half, which has kind of flipped the script. Turnovers only two for Carolina, seven for Kentucky. But the difference and why Kentucky stays on the lead, partner, spraying them from outside. A three-point party for the Wildcats so far. Will it be enough to hold off the surging Tar Heels? See what Kentucky has done during the tournament on the season, just under 40%, Jim. Actually at 40%, making 7 threes per game, the Wildcats have done.
Remember, Henson is back in there with the 4 fouls.
This floor so spread out. Everybody's got a rebound for Carolina if the shot is missed.
Liggins, that's blocked by Barnes. 15 on the shot clock.
Harrison Barnes, about 2 inches taller than Liggins, who really was successful in driving against the Buckeyes Friday. No room to get the shot off there.
Oh, big!
And up and over Zeller. That's Jones. Quickly up ahead to Barnes.
Too easy, too. Roy Williams really upset about that. One pass and a layup on a baseline out of bounds play.
Coach Cal talked a lot about we can't let him beat us in transition. There's the ball. Again, we talked about Friday night. They're good for that combo once a game. And it's Marshall again to Henson. Henson's first field goal since the 14-minute mark, first half.
Dexter Strickland heading to the scorer's table to check in. He's been outstanding here in the second half. Been good all game, but he's picked it up offensively here in the second half.
Jones, back-to-back hoops.
Nicely done. Went to the right hand there, Jim. That's why I call him reversible clothing. He can get you inside and outside.
Tough shot, Barnes. And it bounces off the rim. Jones at both ends.
Like to get a better shot if you're Carolina there. But Barnes can make difficult ones. You need quality looks every trip. Makes sense to go in. Henson, he's got the 4-5.
Hey! Oh, that was awfully close. And he defends it. Marshall, no one there. Liggins Motors pass Barnes, then McDonald, and a foul on Carolina. And it's called on Zeller, his second. For instant analysis and highlights of every tournament game, log on to SI.com. Sixth team foul on North Carolina.
Only four have been committed by Kentucky. So that bodes well for the Wildcats going down the stretch.
Dexter Strickland is set for a short while, and they need his energy back out.
Well, again, every time Carolina seems to be closing this gap, about the closest they've been able to get is four, Jim. That's happened a few times this half. And Kentucky has responded. And again, the resiliency of this team has started really showing up here the last couple of months for Kentucky.
You know, since Carolina won the regular season title and the season finale against Duke, they have been falling behind in a lot of their games. They were down 11 to Washington, trailed in a couple of the ACC tournament games, and they kept depending on the rally. They got 5.5 minutes to pull it off this time.
Well, Liggins made a great play and then gave it back.
Well, there's one they needed. It's Barnes from outside the arc.
And he had words for Liggins, too. He's got to be careful now. No need to get into a jaw-jacking contest. He's got the three fouls. I don't want to pick up a technical that's a personal.
Rejected by Zeller, picked up by Barnes, taken off toward Lamb, and Lamb can cut it to two. Barnes jumped off the block right to the spot of Zeller's rejection and then took it all the way.
Jim, that's big time. 6'8", 230 pounds coming at you with strength and agility. Hoop and Harm and Harrison trying to take it open.
Third foul on Lamb. A three and a three-point play. For Harrison Barnes, 65-63 Kentucky.
Oh, he is feeling it now. He's got his big game struck going. And this is as close as they've been.
A personal six-point run by Barnes. And this is the closest Carolina has been since the first half. Barnes defending.
Darius Miller.
What a shot by Miller.
Big time. Again, he went right to him.
And the shot goes.
That's going to count. It should count. Young fella getting busy here. Here, Jim. That's a special player recognizing that he's got to carry his squad and being willing to do it. He's into the shooting motion when the bump occurred. Miller wonders about it. But that's the rule as it's written. The player is going into that shooting motion and gets bumped. And the basket goes in. It should be continuation, and that's just what it was.
Third foul on Miller. Barnes with the last eight for the Tar Heels.
Yeah, I like Kentucky going to Terrence Jones here against Henson, who has the four fouls.
Oh, Strickland anticipated the pass.
Well, his defense has been off the charts throughout the tournament, Jim. Actually, all season long, really.
And his intensity, which has been there the whole game, has now been picked up by all five on the floor.
Right, well said. Isolation now, two-man game.
To the corner. Four to shoot.
They don't know.
Two to shoot. Knight over Strickland. Oh, Zeller almost tapped it in inadvertently. And Carolina can come down and tie it or take the lead.
You find Harrison Barnes in the post, or coming off the screen, or you get it in the zone. You got the hot hand with Barnes. I think you almost got to try to find him, although he looks like he's trying to help out Zeller get open.
Zeller, Harrelson on his back. And that's going to be called on Harrelson. That's the seventh team foul. We got a break.
I tell you what, Harrison Barnes has been on his own little solo surge of late. Eight straight for Carolina. Zeller will have a chance to even it up.
1-1.
1-1. Yep. And the big fella has been excellent from the line coming into tonight's game. He had made 30 of 36 in the tournament. So you like to have him at the strike.
From 11 down to all square. With 3:18 to play.
Put that seatbelt on, Jim.
I'm all strapped in here, partner. Ready to punch that final ticket to Houston. Carolina on a 10-2 run.
There's a Brandon Knight without the ball now. Dexter Strickland defending him, trying to keep it out of his hands.
Miller with Henson defending. Back over to Knight. He hits another killer shot.
That was a Brandon Knight.
We call him a flatliner, Jim, because he never gets too high or too low. Neither does he, but that's all right.
Strickland flies to the rebound and picked up by Harrison. So again, Kentucky. They see the Carolina charge this time pulling even. And it's Knight again to come right back and very calmly hits the big shot. 3-point lead and possession. Eight to shoot.
Well, you gotta be close to him because he'll pull it from there.
Short this time. Up ahead is Strickland. Two Wildcats coming in on him and Zeller taps it in. That was close.
It was close to a foul, I thought, on Strickland, and then Zeller dangerously close to getting that ball while it was still on the rim.
And a timeout, Kentucky. Zeller almost looked like he knew it and paused just a little bit. For it to fall another inch away from the rim. The tap-in trims it to 1:146 to go. Wildcats to inbound at midcourt.
Good timeout there. John Calipari wants his team to have a play to run in this situation. Carolina wants to try to disrupt whatever it is they're looking to run. You can go a lot of different ways with Kentucky. Liggins, pick and roll. He's got a size advantage on Marshall. He can dribble him into the foul line, maybe get a shot off.
Almost lost it.
Terrence Jones going up against Henson, who has the four fouls.
That's on Strickland. Knight will be shooting a 1-1. Second foul on Strickland, and again coming up next, 60 minutes. Don't want to miss the profile of one great leader, high school basketball coach, just a short distance away from here over in Jersey City. That profile of Bob Hurley coming up 60 minutes after basketball. 1-1. Rims out. Rebound Barnes. With 1:20 to go. Carolina has not led since 4-2 in the first minute and 50 seconds.
You gotta go inside here if you're Carolina. No reason not to. You're in the bonus. You got a guy who can score it in the paint. And Zeller or Barnes. You gotta be really intentional about trying to get this ball inside.
Blocked by Liggins.
1 minute remaining in regulation time.
Will Marshall would have switched hands, maybe put it up with the right hand. That might not have been blocked.
Good call, Jim. You're right. Took it right to the shot blocker by keeping it in his left hand.
To the corner, Liggins hits the three. Makes the bracket one. Puts him up four at the other. Carolina Marshall lost it. Able to save it. Baseline. High pass to Barnes. Puts up the shot. Trying to draw the foul. Doesn't get the call. And there's a reach-in foul. That'll send Knight to the line. And it's on Henson. And he's fouled out.
Big shot. Well, it's hard to tell whether he was actually fully behind the line from our angle.
Boy, that does look awfully close.
Yeah, it looked like he might have gotten his toe on it. I'm not sure. But they gave him a three. I think they'd look at that.
I think they may just take a look at it. Henson fouling out. This was not his typical game.
And then a tough shot at the other end by Barnes as he tried to draw a foul. Still had enough time, only down four, to try to get something better. You panic into that three-point shot, and now you put yourself in a really tough position.
Here's the Ligon shot again, Clark.
Penetration by Miller has been on the...
I'll tell you, that right foot looks like it's on the line.
Boy, I tell you.
That really looks close.
Oh, that's very close. Close enough to be reviewed.
There's still time for these officials to make a change on it, to review it.
Oh, that looks like that right foot is on the line. I know his tennis shoe is blue and black and the line is black, but anytime you touch any part of that line, it's got to be a deuce.
The officials now conferring with Calipari. And they're heading over to a monitor. Well, just think how big this call is. If it knocks a point off the board, you got a 1-1 at the line coming up. One possession game at 72-69.
That's really close, Jim. I mean, from there, it looks to me as though he's got a toe on the line. That's what it looks like right there.
Does to me, too.
Yeah, it looks like he's got a toe on the line, which would make it a two.
Well, that right there,
that looks like a three right there. That's the angle, yep.
Wow.
From that angle, from up top, we couldn't tell, but from the side, there's just a skosh of space, a smidgen.
6 years ago, on this very date, it was in Austin watching Kentucky and Michigan State in a double overtime regional final. And there was a big question mark about a two or a three with Patrick Sparks. Yep. That was some thriller. Michigan State eventually prevailed, went on to St. Louis in Final Four. So that holds up. That was worth another look, though.
Yeah, it sure was.
And the conclusive replay keeps it at 73-69. Knight at the line, 1-1. 18.8 to play.
Kentucky has nobody on the line at night. He missed his last, and you don't expect an 80% shooter after just missing a free throw to miss another one.
Kentucky has not been to the Final Four since Tubby Smith took them there and won the title in 1998. Used to be, oh, you kind of counted on it every other year, but it's been a long time, and that's Calipari's father, Vince.
Well, it doesn't have to be a three. Taking a lot of time.
Barnes again. That shot well defended. Chased down by Knight. He's heading back to the line with 9.3 to play.
Well, I don't think you had to shoot the three. I think you just could have drove it to the goal hard for a two-pointer. Try to stretch it out. Because if you miss the three, it really almost makes it a wrap.
We saw Coach Cal's father, Vince, 77 years young, beginning of the season. John's mother, Donna, passed away November the 28th. Father has not been really leaving the home until a couple of late season road trips. Yeah. They were married for 54 years. He would have cheered on his son. And maybe have a chance to go down to Houston, just 9 seconds away. Go with the team to the Final Four.
Looks like they're on their way, Jim.
It sure does. After 13 years away.
Boy, what a resilient effort though in the second half as Carolina clawed back and tied it, but could never get over the hump.
And that will do it. Wildcats going back to an old Kentucky home, the Final Four.
And it is the end of the game, ladies and gentlemen.
This game got pulled even. And then Kentucky just took over in the closing 2 minutes.